Bear, see, lest this...
Dark Souls 2 turned 7 years old in 2021, and in that time it's maintained its reputation as divisive among the Souls fanbase. It's consistently regarded as the black sheep of the series for a multitude of reasons. Some are totally valid, some are exaggerated, and a few are so very subjective to the point of being considered positives depending on who you ask. Strangely enough, however, I've seen some people claim that Dark Souls 2 is their overall least favorite, yet at the same time, they've replayed it more than the others, which sounds odd for the so-called black sheep. But if there's one thing that even some of the most fervent detractors of the title can agree on with those who love it, it's that it boasts the greatest amount of build variety and replayability in the franchise. The volume of armor, weapons, magic, and rings, all of which can be mixed and matched to your heart's content, is simply unprecedented. And the game pulls it off without resorting to a tiring, and overused as of late, Diablo-like loot system that overloads you with constant drops, rarity levels, and randomized stats. It begs people who care about build variety to replay the game over and over and over again. And it works. It worked on me, it worked on several of my friends, and it worked on some other content creators I follow. I agree with plenty of the complaints raised about the game, and I don't consider it to be the overall best, but I've replayed Dark Souls 2 more often than I've replayed Dark Souls 1, 3, Bloodborne, and Demon's Souls combined, and it's because of the immense number of options it offers. Frankly, it's quite a surprise the game gives so much, considering how rough its production seemed to have been, with the original director being presumably fired and the replacement, Yui Tanimura, basically throwing most of the game together in about a year. In the hundreds of hours I've spent with both the vanilla version of the title and the newer, remixed version, Scholar of the First Sin, I've learned a lot about its approach to replayability. Let me pose a quick question to you. What is the crux of build variety? It might sound like some sort of deep, philosophical game theory prompt at first, but the answer is pretty straightforward. Options. More specifically, viable options. When a game gives you the freedom to develop your character the way you want to, it's ultimately the upper limit of viable options you can actually depend on to get you through the game that dictates how strong build variety is. Games can do this in different ways, especially RPGs, as there are often two ways to develop characters in this genre: stat point allocation and equipment optimization. Some games pick one or the other, but a lot of them do both, which doubles the potential avenues for character growth, and the Souls games are some of them. Not only do you spend souls to acquire soul levels to put into your attributes, but you also upgrade weapons and mix and match armor for the optimal attack and defensive ratings for your build. Both systems act independently and together in differing aspects when giving more power to your character. Increasing your soul level can give you higher natural defense, more HP and stamina, and greater equip burden. Upgrading your gear obviously makes your equipment better. However, they also join together with the scaling system, so in order to make the most of the type of weapons or magic you're using, you have to focus on their most supported attribute: strength, dexterity, intelligence, or faith. And if a weapon's scaling isn't strong enough to your liking, you can take advantage of infusions to bolster it at the sacrifice of other stats that might not be relevant to your current playstyle. So not only is there a lot of options in general, there's also a ton of wiggle room for optimization. But none of what I'm saying right now is necessarily exclusive specifically to Dark Souls 2. It applies to pretty much all of the Souls games. So what does it do differently from the rest? Well, there's a few things that all come together to make Dark Souls 2's build variety greater than the others. Let's go over them one by one. First is the sheer number of weapons, armor, magic, and rings in the game. In a series where mixing and matching equipment is encouraged, having a higher base number of each category only increases the total number of combinations. Let's go over those numbers. First is Demon's Souls, the remake specifically, which sports a grand total of 80 weapons, 17 shields, 26 armor sets, 30 rings, and 34 spells. Next is Dark Souls 1, which features 139 weapons, including spell tools, 43 shields, not including Dark Hand and the Skull Lantern, 58 armor sets, 41 rings, and 72 spells. Then there's Dark Souls 3, which has 221 weapons, again including spell tools, 59 shields, 91 armor sets, 116 rings, including upgraded variants, and 105 spells. Finally, Dark Souls 2 comes in, boasting an incredible 257 weapons, 75 shields, 106 armor sets, 122 rings, again including upgraded variants, and 106 spells, outnumbering all other Souls games in all categories, including its own sequel. And I know some people feel like the game has weapons for the sake of weapons, quantity over quality, they might say, and suggest that the majority is useless junk. But after playing through the game dozens of times and personally trying out many of them, I feel like that's a bit dismissive of the finer details of each weapon's attributes and capabilities. Not every weapon can be completely boiled down to just their attack rating, weight, and scaling. Those are probably the most important pieces of information, yes, but they still have smaller, specific attributes that people can and should consider, because they can add up to alter whether or not they're truly worth using for the particular build you're going for. It's worth thinking about a weapon's single-handed and double-handed moveset, left-handed moveset, damage type, infusion scaling, which upgrade materials they use, whether they have a sweet spot or not, and their ease of acquisition. Some weapons that you can get very early on seem weak and worth tossing into the bin, but they can still prove their worth with a high infusion bonus, good scaling, or a strong attack that changes its damage type. I've played through the entire game with weapons I've gotten in the first few areas before. It can be pretty surprising how brightly they shine when you manage to squeeze out every bit of potential they have. There's also power stancing to consider, which is the game's way of supporting dual wielding. Basically, two weapons of similar type can allow you to power stance them and access a new moveset, assuming you have 1.5 times the attribute points for the weapon with the highest requirements. You can combine straight sword and curved sword, great hammer and great axe, a dagger and thrusting sword, a spear and a katana, etc. Sadly, power stancing is exclusive to Dark Souls 2, because 3 replaced it with paired weapons, and honestly, it just doesn't feel the same to me. The game also has a sort of hard upgrade hierarchy, where some early game weapons have stronger late game versions, but with their own separate benefits. For example, you can buy a spear from Lenegrast the moment you unlock his shop. And while it's the most basic of spear weapons, its strong attack is a sweep that does blunt damage instead of piercing, making it a useful weapon against armored enemies. However, there's also the Partisan, which is the hard upgrade from the spear, because it has the exact same moveset, but a longer reach, slightly higher base damage, and S-tier scaling in dex, as opposed to B with the spear, which becomes A at plus 10. And they both use normal Titanite for upgrades, which is very plentiful in this game. However, the Partisan is also slightly heavier and has steeper requirements for both strength and dexterity, despite strength being a paltry E-tier. For a lot of people, especially those doing dex builds, going from the spear to the Partisan will be a no-brainer, but there can be some instances where you might want to stick with the spear, such as wanting to keep the C-tier strength scaling you get at plus 10. However, if you plan on infusing your weapon with an element, you might want to go with the Partisan, because its dex scaling still stays at A after the infusion. But then again, just because you're using a spear doesn't necessarily mean you're going all in on dex. There's several directions to go between just these two weapons, and there are a few more hard upgrade cases like it, such as going from the broadsword early in the game to the Drakekeeper's sword later. In regards to armor, it's really useful to have many different choices that cover every inch of the weight and defense rating spectrum to find the perfect combination of stats that don't impede your movement. Plus, let's be honest here, we all like fashion. I know you could say it's not necessarily crucial to the experience, but when you're familiar enough with the game to feel comfortable with wearing anything you wish, Fashion Souls is all that's left to care about regarding armor. And with a whopping 106 armor sets, there's some pretty fashionable stuff in this game. Going back to weapons, there are indeed some useless or gimmick equipment, like the Handmaid's Ladle, which is given to you as a reward for killing an optional Cyclops enemy in the tutorial area. But I think all of us, including From Software, know exactly why weapons like that exist. Challenge runs. Which is a concept that is purely for the sake of experienced players finding new ways to have fun. And thanks to Dark Souls 2's unmatched variety, it has the greatest challenge or gimmick run potential in the whole series, with a ton of rules you can impose on yourself, including a covenant you can join as soon as you first enter Majula that further increases the difficulty of the game. Regardless of whether you're playing it straight or not, the game offers you a ton of wiggle room to try and experiment. This leads us into our second point in the video, the upgrade system. Weapon upgrading in Souls games used to be pretty damn unintuitive and wildly archaic. Demon's Souls has it the absolute worst, and unfortunately the remake didn't take the opportunity to smooth it out. Getting a single weapon to plus 10 on a normal upgrade path requires a grand total of 99 upgrade materials. Shards, large shards, chunks, and pure. Because each level requires the same amount of materials before it, plus more. Diverging down an elemental-infused path doesn't make things easier either. In fact, you'll need a new family of upgrade materials which might even be harder to acquire than the normal one. Also, in order to create a boss weapon, you typically need an upgraded weapon to serve as the base to turn into the boss weapon, regardless of whether or not you'd actually use the weapon being sacrificed. It's not a fun time. Furthermore, boss weapons couldn't be upgraded after they were crafted. Dark Souls simplifies things a tiny bit, but still remains fairly complex because of infused paths still requiring their own materials and a decent amount of them. But thankfully, it's no longer anywhere close to 90 fucking 9 in total. Boss weapons could be upgraded now too, but they still couldn't be infused. Then Dark Souls 2 comes along, and gives us the most uncomplicated, no-nonsense system in the whole series thus far, and without sacrificing customization. Then Dark Souls 3 made the smart decision to, more or less, keep it the same way. There are only three upgrade materials in Dark Souls 2. Normal Titanite, once again divided into shards, large shards, chunks, and now slabs, Twinkling Titanite, which is used for special weapons, and Petrified Dragon Bones, which is used for boss weapons. Speaking of boss weapons, you no longer need to upgrade and subsequently sacrifice another weapon in order to make one. The only thing you need is the appropriate boss's soul and the appropriate vendor who can craft the weapon. That's it. And guess what? You can now infuse boss weapons too, so the strongest weapons in the game can become even stronger. Even better, infusing any weapon no longer requires a new family of upgrade materials. You can infuse a weapon with any element or status effect at any point during its upgrade path, and continue upgrading it using its normal upgrade materials. Meaning, if you upgrade a longsword, for example, to plus 8 using normal Titanite, and decide you want to infuse it with lightning using a boltstone, you can do that, and it'll give the weapon the appropriate amount of base lightning damage and faith scaling for a plus 8 lightning longsword. And you can continue to upgrade the weapon with normal Titanite after that. You don't have to move to Twinkling Titanite or Dragon Bones. This remarkably simple and easy-to-use approach to upgrading weapons just makes things so much less of a headache when developing your build, and it doesn't trade off any amount of customization to achieve this. You can grab any weapon, upgrade it as much as you want, infuse it over and over again to try different things, and you don't need any meticulous pre-planning to do so. This immense amount of elbow room allows players to just wing it during their playthrough without feeling like they made some sort of drastic mistake in upgrading their weapon. Giving a player free space to improvise with their gear without making them feel like they're wasting precious resources for not sticking to a detailed design helps build variety and replayability. It encourages the player to make choices and try different things on the fly. It also helps that all of these upgrade and infusion materials aren't that rare. They can all be farmed or purchased reliably at different points throughout the game. It's not fun when a game decides that materials that are crucial to the development of your character should be absolute hell to acquire. In fact, there's so much upgrade materials, you can be just as experimental and improvisational with armor too. It's a great system, and Dark Souls 3 makes it arguably better due to the sheer fact that there's only one blacksmith who can do everything, as opposed to one who can only do basic reinforcement, and one unlocked later in a different location who can do advanced stuff, like in every other Souls title. I know there's some kind of point to be made somewhere about Souls games making you commit to your decisions, etc., etc., and that line of thinking works in a game with more limited choices. But as we've already established, this game has 332 weapons and shields. Do you really want to be shackled down to only a few of them per playthrough? Personally, I do not. With so many choices, the journey of transitioning from one weapon to another as you progress through the game plays its own part in making each playthrough unique, and it's almost as important as the weapon you end up sticking with for the rest of the game, and the majorly simplified upgrade system helps with that. Of course, with so many weapons to try out, that means there's a lot of different attribute requirements from weapon to weapon that you'll need in order to really use anything on a whim. As I mentioned, pretty much every single weapon in the game demands a certain minimum of either strength, dexterity, intelligence, and faith to wield it. Don't those minimums get in the way of true improvisation, you may ask? Well, that question leads me to my next point, the soul economy. I know that sounds like a term that would be used in a Metal Gear Solid-inspired spin-off or something, but the answer to that question is actually no, and that's thanks to Dark Souls 2's generous soul economy. What do I mean by that? Well, think back to other Souls games. If you progressed through them at a normal, consistent pace and did not go out of your way to grind or dedicate a significant amount of time to co-op, what soul level would you be when you finally hit the end credits? 60, 70, maybe 80? This is important because the upper limit of how high your soul level would be at the end of a normal playthrough dictates how many points you can put into each character attribute. Eventually, due to soul levels costing more souls with each level, you'll eventually reach a point where the grind for just one more simply isn't worth the effort. In addition to the four weapon-related attributes I listed earlier, Souls games also have vitality, endurance, and a few game-specific ones like luck, resistance, vigor, and adaptability. Each of these attributes has one or more major stats tied to them, and they go up in varying increments when you put a soul level into their respective attribute. However, each attribute also has at least one soft cap. A soft cap is the point where the attribute's stats increase in smaller increments from then on. For example, in Dark Souls 2, you level up Vigor to increase your maximum HP. When Vigor goes from 19 to 20, it increases your maximum HP by 30 points. However, 20 Vigor is also the first soft cap for the attribute, so when you go from 20 to 21, you'll get only 20 more points into HP. This stays consistent until you hit 50 Vigor, which is the second soft cap. After that, you only get 5 more HP per point, thus making Vigor borderline useless from then on. Because of this system, the allocation of your soul levels is important, because if you choose a primary stat to focus on your character, you typically want to hit, or at least come close, to soft cap to maximize stat increases for the investment. But because you usually end games at around level 60 to 70, you'll likely be able to do that for just one attribute, maybe two at most. And spreading your soul levels thin across all of them is typically a really bad idea unless you know what you're doing and you have a very specific build that calls for it. Dark Souls 2 turns this on its head as well, because soul levels go up in cost per point at much smaller increments. In Dark Souls 1, going from level 70 to 71 costs 29,186 souls. But in Dark Souls 2, it costs a measly 7,697. That's a discount of almost 75%. As a result of these overhauled calculations, you can end a playthrough of Dark Souls 2 at anywhere between soul level 120 to 150, double the level you might end other games at. And you might assume that the aforementioned attributes might have been overhauled with this in mind, so they increase in smaller amounts, and soft caps are higher. But that's not necessarily the case. Soft caps in Dark Souls 2 are still the same as they usually are, 20, 30, 40, or 50 points depending. And this doesn't utterly break combat, as the game still functions perfectly fine. The beautiful thing about ending a Souls game with a higher soul level is being able to select more than just one primary attribute to focus on. Now you can hit a soft cap for not just one or two attributes, but three or maybe even four in one run through the game. Remember how much I talked about mixing and matching weapons and armor? Well, now you can do the same with attributes thanks to a soul economy that isn't so strict. I know there's a point to be made about certain attributes being mandatory to level up for a large number of builds, and thus waste soul levels on, such as adaptability, which is needed to gain more invincibility frames for rolls. I do understand that complaint. To reach a decent amount of iframes, you need to hit about 15 adaptability, or more specifically, 92 agility, which grants 10 iframes during a roll. But depending on your starting class, that's as little as 3 points away. In any other Souls game, that'd be a somewhat significant investment. But with Dark Souls 2's generous economy, you can hit 15 adaptability from almost any number below that in one, maybe two boss fights. With a total of 41 bosses in the game, that's pretty fast. And agility is only relevant to builds where your primary form of defense will be rolling anyway. You can totally get through the game with just blocking. Might be difficult at some points, but it's possible. In other Souls games, choosing which attribute to put a soul level into is an important decision, and the weight of that number going up by one is pretty hefty. But like with other things, Dark Souls 2 alleviates that pressure and gives more room to just wing it. If you start a playthrough intending on a strength build, but you come across a dexterity weapon you want to try, but you need 5 more points into dex before you can use it, you can spend those points on dex and it won't practically ruin your character like it would in Demon's Souls or Dark Souls 1, especially since those games don't have respecking like Dark Souls 2 and 3 do. I know there's yet another argument to be made here, something like, but wouldn't it be more balanced or challenging if you had to actually stick to the same type of weapons at the end as you did in the beginning? And I see what people mean when they say this, but my thoughts on that is, I don't want to be forced to stick to a category of weapons. Instead, I want the game to make me want to stick to it because they're just as viable as the others. And in this game, they are. Strength weapons, dexterity weapons, magic tools, straight swords, great swords, curved swords, axes, spears, bows, they all have good choices planted all around the game. And the transition of starting game weapons to end game weapons is rife with options. And the beginning of the game is actually a new point to touch on. Another interesting aspect of Dark Souls 2 is the structure of its world, because it's extremely open at the very beginning. It's not a feature that's totally unique to this game. Demon's Souls is also very open, allowing the player to travel down 5 different linear paths in whatever order they desire. But Dark Souls 2 has a different layout, partially thanks to worlds not being disconnected. For the first half of the game, there are several branches that lead to bosses you need to slay to enter the second half of the game. And at the very start, it's possible to skip certain areas entirely or take alternate routes to end up at the same key location. Once you finish the tutorial area and reach Majula for the first time, you're free to head to the Forest of Fallen Giants, Hades Tower of Flame, or jump down into the pit. If you go to Hades, you're able to reach No Man's Wharf, which leads to Lost Bastille, which is where you get one of the 4 boss souls needed to enter the second half of the game. Alternatively, you can go to Forest of Fallen Giants, defeat Pursuer, and skip No Man's Wharf entirely to enter Lost Bastille from a different starting spot. If you're feeling ballsy, you can go down into the pit immediately, and you can choose to avoid Grave of Saints or not. But regardless, you end up in the gutter, which leads to Black Gulch, another area where you acquire one of the mandatory boss souls. The paths leading to the Iron Keep and Brightstone Cove Seldora are more linear, and typically they're entered after doing the easier areas first, but it's possible to open and enter them before finishing those earlier paths. And depending on what equipment you wish to acquire quickly, you might want to do that. Now, this isn't me trying to start some debate about which Souls game has the best structure, because they all have their pros and cons. While Dark Souls 1 and 3, especially 3, are more on rails in their progression, their individual areas are larger and more complex, allowing for more secrets to be discovered. And Dark Souls 1 in particular does do a better job at making its areas feel more connected and the whole map feel cohesive. But Dark Souls 2 has a structure that leans into the game's strength of options, and that's the important detail here. Basically, there's many different ways to finish the first half of the game. All paths are mandatory, yes, but you can ultimately do them in whatever order you choose. And several areas are completely optional to begin with. It's only when you reach the middle point at Shrine of Winter where the game converges and progression more or less becomes a straight line. Letting the player progress in the way they want at the beginning of the game allows them to make a straight line to their preferred starting point. It was, and is, thanks to the remake, one of the best aspects of Demon's Souls, because you were able to make a quick sprint for the stuff you want as soon as the game truly started, and complete the vast majority of the rest of the game with that equipment. Sure, a good chunk of the best gear in Dark Souls 2 is still located in the latter half, but a lot of the endgame viable stuff is still accessible reasonably soon from the moment you enter Majula. And by front-loading the game with a decent selection of good equipment you can grab quickly if you're experienced enough, you create a ton of potential starting points for builds. I think that pretty much covers every major aspect of Dark Souls 2 that lends itself towards its immense build variety and unparalleled replayability within the Souls franchise. I wouldn't be surprised if I missed a couple details though, as it is a big game. As I said before, it's a divisive title for a lot of people, but despite that, it's the Souls game I've replayed the most, and for good reason. I truly feel like I can play however I want without the game constantly trying to nudge me towards one build or playstyle or another. If I wanted to do a strength-focused playthrough, for example, depending on how heavy or fast I want to be, I could end the game with anything from a bandit axe to a craftsman's hammer, a red rust sword, a Drakekeeper's Greataxe, a Mastodon Greatsword, the Dragon Tooth, the King's Ultra Greatsword, or anything in between. It's all viable. Some bosses or areas might be made a little easier with specific types of equipment, yes, but individual player skill can help fill that gap. Or if you've invested enough soul levels into different attributes, you can simply swap to a different loadout entirely to fit the situation. It's totally possible to do that thanks to the game's generous soul economy, and especially thanks to the fact that Dark Souls 2 was the first Souls game to allow soul level respecking. So if you wish to completely undo your point allocation and go from, say, a melee-only quality build to a pure hexer, you're more than welcome to do so. The game provides many avenues to make that transition in a single playthrough. It's not a perfect game, and many people are willing to scream until they're blue in the face about all its weaknesses, but its greatest strength of options and choices make it a Souls experience that's different from the others, and that strength draws certain people in a way the other titles don't, and that sense of freedom is why there's a fairly large amount of staunch Dark Souls 2 loyalists who will continue to love the game in spite of its shortcomings. I hope one day we see another game directed by Yui Tanimura. As I mentioned at the start of the video, he had to throw most of this game together in about a year after the first director left development. I'd like to see what he's capable of with a full dev cycle. This concludes my thoughts on Dark Souls 2 and how it creates replayability and build variety. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you around.